I'm Dave Jackman. I'm a physician here at the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute, where I serve as our medical director for our Clinical Pathways program and as a senior physician in the Lowe Center for Thoracic Oncology. Today, I'll be taking your questions about advanced lung cancer.
Thank you, Dr. Jackman. For everyone who's watching, feel free to write your questions in the comments and we'll try to answer them. Let's get started. So, Dr. Jackman, what do researchers know about what causes advanced lung cancer?
So lung cancer has been a challenging cancer in so many ways. We know that cigarette smoking remains the most important and common cause of lung cancer, that cigarette smoking increases your risk of getting lung cancer by over 20-fold, and we can't underplay that enough. So if you're out there and you smoke, do everything you can to try to stop. In terms of other specific causes, it's incredibly hard for us to know that. We know that there are a number of things that play a role. We know things like radon and radiation have a role. But it's impossible to tell for an individual patient your cancer is caused by this versus that.
And what is the difference between small cell and non-small cell lung cancer? Do they have different prognosis and are they treated differently?
Fair enough. Yeah, so when we think about lung cancer, we divide it into two main categories, small cell and non-small cell. We make the distinction not because one is necessarily better or worse than the other, but because we fundamentally do approach them differently, that our treatment approaches are different. With small cell lung cancer, surgery is in many cases, not all, but in many cases, not the best option. And oftentimes we're thinking about chemotherapy and perhaps in combination with radiation. In non-small cell, it depends on what stage we capture your tumor and diagnose your tumor, and surgery may be an option for some of these.
We actually already had a couple questions come in from our viewers on Facebook. So right now, this is two-part, what are the main treatment options for patients with advanced lung cancer, and do you think chemo and radiation will be done away with someday?
Fair enough. So let's start with the first question. What are the main treatment options for advanced lung cancer? So I want to define a few things. So by advanced lung cancer, we generally mean cancer that has spread to other areas of the body and is not located just in the lung or in the chest. The next piece is wanting to make sure, again, we distinguish different treatment options for small cell versus non-small cell. If it's okay, I'm going to focus my answer right now on non-small cell because this represents about 88% of lung cancers and so is the majority of what I imagine our viewers are asking about. When we think about patients with advanced or stage 4 non-small cell lung cancer, our options today are much broader than they had ever been before. In general, in my mind, I put our options into three main categories. The first is what we call targeted therapies. That is, you know, at places like this, and in many places across the country, we try to test your lung cancer and learn as much as we can about it. And if we see that you have a mutation or a change in the genes, in specific genes, we may have a targeted medication that may be the most appropriate first step for you. In those patients who do not have a targetable mutation, then our next question is, should immunotherapy be part of your initial treatment strategy? And for that, we're looking at a number of tests. The one that we use most often is looking at expression of a certain protein called PD-L1. It's a protein that's found on the surface of some lung cancers, and if we see that the protein expression is high, that we have a great expression, greater than 50%, then we think about immunotherapy, a relatively new class of medicines, as being the appropriate first treatment. And in those patients for whom either targeted therapy or immunotherapy are not the right first strategies, chemotherapy may be the correct first strategy. And this often will be some form of a combination of medications. And there are too many different combinations to go into right now. Regarding your second question, or the second part of this question, do we think that we will someday be able to eliminate chemotherapy or radiation from the treatment plan? I mean, I would think about it a little bit differently. I think ultimately our goal here and everywhere should be, how do we cure lung cancer? And while we recognize that chemotherapy and radiation, or even other treatments like immunotherapy, do have side effects, and we wish that we could manage these better or prevent these, and something that's always in our front of mind. Ultimately, you know, we think that all of these things are likely to play an important role in in being able to treat and hopefully eventually cure lung cancer. So I don't know that asking the question, will we be able to get rid of these things, is necessarily the right one. I think ultimately the question is, will we be able to get rid of lung cancer, and what role will these things continue to play in that journey?
So a couple questions about diagnosing lung cancer and some early stage things. What symptoms should prompt someone to go to their doctor for a lung exam? Can x-rays be used in early detection?
Great set of questions. You know, so when we think about lung cancer, it can present with a variety of symptoms. Many, not surprisingly, are respiratory symptoms, worsening shortness of breath, cough, especially coughing up blood. And so these are something that, you know, should prompt a visit to your doctor. Sometimes lung cancer presents with more generalized symptoms, and this could be increasing fatigue or weight loss, or generalized pain or pain somewhere else. And so all of these are things that should prompt a visit to your doctor, not only for lung cancer, but just for management of that symptom. In addition, I think it's important to point out the increasing role of lung cancer screening. And it's not something that we do with x-rays per se, but it's something that we do with something called a low-dose CT scan. Over the last decade, we've seen an increasing role for using low-dose CT scans as a screening test to try to find lung cancers earlier, much in the same way that we use mammograms to find breast cancers early. And this is not a test that has been recommended for everyone, but it is recommended for those patients that are at higher risk for lung cancer because of their smoking histories. And so in general, if patients have smoked at least 30 pack years, one pack a year for 30 years represents 30 pack years, that we have seen evidence that using lung cancer CT screening has been beneficial in trying to detect lung cancers earlier and hopefully at a stage where we're better able to treat or potentially cure them.
What is biomarker testing, and should lung cancer patients undergo biomarker testing for lung cancer?
That's a great question, and one that is constantly evolving. I think that one of the great strides we've made in cancer in general, and lung cancer specifically, is the recognition that the more we learn about your cancer, the better we're able to precisely target therapies that have the best chance of working for you. And so in lung cancer right now, there are several tests that would be considered standard across the board for anyone with metastatic non-small cell lung cancer that is considered non-squamous. These represent looking for mutations in EGFR and BRAF, and looking for rearrangements or translocations in two other genes, ALK, ALK, and ROS1, ROS1. In addition, all patients with metastatic non-small cell lung cancer, regardless of type, at this point, I think, should be tested for PD-L1 expression, which we had alluded to earlier in our conversation.
Do you think further targeted molecular testing will continue to extend the expected life expectancy for late-stage lung cancer? So a question from a viewer.
Absolutely. I certainly hope so, and I think it has already played an important step in doing that. You know, here at Dana-Farber, we have been at the vanguard of discovering the role of many of these tests, and it's something that we've been reaching out to do even more broadly. So while the standard recommendations are for the four genes that I talked about earlier, in many cases we try to pursue something called next generation sequencing so that we're looking not at four genes but literally looking at hundreds of genes. And these were defined by doctors from throughout our institute, not just in lung cancer, to figure out what genes do we think are the most important in cancer in general. Can we study them and try to learn things across cancers? You know, for instance, we know that RET rearrangements are important in a certain form of thyroid cancer, and we've discovered that a small percentage of lung cancers have these rearrangements too. And so can we take some of what we've learned in thyroid cancer and apply it to our patients with lung cancer that have the same rearrangement? And so I think we're always trying to learn across cancers where we can.
You started to mention this, but can you talk a little bit more about how immunotherapy is used in treatment of advanced lung cancer? Can you combine it with chemo? And if so, who is an ideal candidate?
Super. So when we think about immunotherapy, I think it's best to start the conversation with what is immunotherapy? For lung cancer, these refer to a specific set of medications, most of which have come into play over the last 5 years. You may have heard of some of these, pembrolizumab, nivolumab, atezolizumab, and most recently, durvalumab are the ones that have had a space in lung cancer. You may know them more familiarly as Opdivo or Tecentriq or Keytruda, and you see some of the commercials. What these are not medicines that directly attack the cancer, but rather what they try to do is they try to teach your immune system how to better recognize and thus attack the cancer. We are currently using them in non-small cell lung cancer, certainly for patients as a second or third line treatment for advanced disease, and in selected patients for use in the first line setting, certainly for those whose PD-L1 expression is higher than 50%. In terms of where this goes next, that is a great question and is actively being studied. We're looking at combining these with chemotherapy. We're looking at combining them with other immunotherapy agents to see if we can make them more powerful, to make them work for more patients and make them make their action last longer. And so this is an active area of research here at Dana-Farber and across the world.
A couple questions from our Facebook viewers, going back to diagnosis a little bit.
Sure.
One viewer asks, can you detect cancer at a molecular level prior to a tumor? And someone else is wondering if lung cancer is hereditary. Are there any genetic tests?
Super. So in terms of our ability to detect cancer, and this doesn't just apply to lung cancer, but across the board, we do not yet have a blood test or other mechanism to detect lung cancer, though we are actively working on it. In terms of is lung cancer hereditary, the answer there is our understanding of hereditary mechanisms for lung cancer is an evolution. You know, we have detected some families that have a specific mutation, something called the T790M, in their genes, not just in the cancer, but in their genes that makes they and some of their family members at higher risk for lung cancer. But I want to make sure that this is clear. This is incredibly rare. One of our primary investigators, Jeff Oxnard, has been working on studying this kind of broadly across the country, and it is something that we're trying to understand better, not only in terms of this mechanism, but are there other genes or other mechanisms? That having been said, for the vast majority of patients, this does not apply, and so there's not a test to look for hereditary lung cancer outside of those few families for which it applies, the way that we look for at certain genes for a more common hereditary disposition for things like colon cancer or breast cancer.
Great. And is there any evidence that checkpoint inhibitors should be used in stage 2 or 3 non-small cell lung cancer? And if you can elaborate again on stage 4 as well.
Sure. So checkpoint inhibitors is another word for the immunotherapy drugs that we had mentioned earlier. Before, they were relegated primarily for patients with metastatic disease, stage 4 disease, and we've already spoken about that a little bit. More recently, based on the PACIFIC trial, which was presented at the European Society of Medical Oncology this past September, we're seeing a role specifically for durvalumab, one of the checkpoint inhibitors, for patients with stage 3 disease who have had chemo and radiation. In the past, for these patients, after chemo and radiation, we didn't have something additionally to do that had clear value. And so we watched these patients closely, hoping that their cancer didn't come back. What we've seen now is in this study, after you get chemo and radiation for unresectable stage 3 disease, patients who went on to receive a year's worth of checkpoint inhibitor, in this case durvalumab, had a much longer time before or if their cancer came back compared to patients who did the usual, just got the chemo and radiation. So this is coming into play in terms of how we take care of stage 3 patients. It has not yet had a clear role for our stage 2 patients.
What therapy should you receive when you fail a checkpoint inhibitor? Can another checkpoint inhibitor work?
Yep. So I want to be cautious. Obviously, you know, each case is different, that having been, and it depends in part on what you've received before. If you've only received a checkpoint inhibitor and have not received anything else, certainly we want to think about chemotherapy options, or if a targeted mutation was discovered, want to strongly consider an appropriate targeted therapy for you. In terms of switching solely from one immunotherapy agent to another, it's not clear to us that switching from, say, pembrolizumab to nivolumab or vice versa necessarily has any clear role. But we are looking, and this is where, you know, certainly one wants to think about clinical trials. There are a number of clinical trials for patients who have had a standard immunotherapy agent after it stops working. Should we be thinking about some clinical trial that maybe combines the immunotherapy agent with something else? But I think just switching from one immunotherapy agent to another hasn't been a clear strategy.
Great. And can you speak a little bit more about possible available clinical trials? Are there any ongoing right now? And who is the ideal patient to join a clinical trial?
Great. Let's talk a little bit about clinical trials first, because I think the landscape for clinical trials has changed so much over the last 10 to 20 years. You know, I think for some folks at home, they think that clinical trials are what you do when you run out of other options. And if there's anything I can do to dispel that notion, let me take the time to do that. That clinical trials are, each clinical trial has a specific setting that it's focused on. Some clinical trials, yes, are for patients who have exhausted other options, but many more are for patients who are receiving their first therapy for lung cancer or their second therapy for lung cancer. So the time to explore clinical trials isn't necessarily when you've exhausted other options. It's from the time you're diagnosed. There may be some exciting and potentially beneficial clinical trials available to you at that time. And so to come to a center like Dana-Farber, it's important to try to think about doing that earlier rather than later, and ideally before you've even started on another therapy, so that, you know, if you might be eligible for a clinical trial, you still have that potential eligibility. Once you start on something, well, then that's what should be pursued until we figure out whether that works, and only after that could we consider a clinical trial. So I think coming earlier rather than later is a key consideration. In terms of what clinical trials are out there, literally hundreds of clinical trials are out there. We purposely, and by we I mean the scientific community, don't all do the same trial. And there's a lot of reasons for that, and perhaps the most important of which is if we all did the same thing, we wouldn't be able to explore as many different avenues of research. And so we all do things that we think are important, that we think we do particularly well, but the trials we have might be different than the trials that might exist at another institution elsewhere in the state or elsewhere in the country. How do you find out about clinical trials? In part, it's coming to places and hearing what we have to offer. In part, it's looking online that the National Cancer Institute runs a website, cancer.gov, for which there is a search engine to look for clinical trials. And every clinical trial that exists in this country has to register with the NCI for that express purpose. And so if you put in what cancer you have and what your zip code is, and how far you'd be willing to travel, it's at least a start to get a sense of what clinical trials might be in your area.
Great. Couple questions from a few of our viewers. Do you see cases of stage 4 or 5 lung cancer with zero symptoms present?
So we do. So in terms of stage 4, so lung cancer is staged from 1 to 4. And stage 4, again, is for those patients with metastatic disease. And indeed, there are some patients who have their cancer found incidentally. You know, they were going to hip surgery and they had to get a chest x-ray prior to operation, and lo and behold, we find a cancer that wasn't otherwise known. So do we find some patients who present without symptoms? The answer is yes. In fact, you know, what's tremendously disturbing and upsetting is the fact that in this day and age, at the time that someone has their lung cancer diagnosed, more than half of them, greater than 50% of lung cancer patients, will already have stage 4 disease from the time of diagnosis. And so that's why lung cancer screening is important, and why, you know, talking with your doctors early and often is important.
Another question from a Facebook viewer. Why are there so many non-smoker young Asian women ages 30 to 45, for example, diagnosed with lung cancer? Is there any research around this?
Yep. So we have come to recognize over the last 20 years that lung cancer is an important disease in non-smokers as well as in smokers. In this country, about 15% of all lung cancers, 20% of women with lung cancer and about 10% of men with lung cancer, had never been smokers. You know, we say, oh, only 10 to 20%. Well, but there's about 220,000 new cases of lung cancer in this country a year. So 15% of that is about 33,000 new cases of lung cancer happening in the United States every year in patients who had never smoked. So this is critical and important. In terms of the why, the answer remains a mystery. That is to say, you know, people here and elsewhere are exploring this, but we don't have a firm reason to know. You know, we know that there are other things that play a role. As we mentioned, we talk about things like secondhand smoke. We talk about radiation and radon. We talk about other things, all of which we know may play a role for an individual patient. As for why we see such a high incidence in Asian never smokers, that's a harder one, and folks have been looking at the question. We don't have a clear answer to that as yet.
A couple questions about prevention and things people can do to prevent lung cancer. Is there anything someone could do besides not smoking or having someone's house checked for radon that can reduce risk? What are your thoughts on e-cigarettes and the effects on the lungs?
Yeah, so our viewers are sending in excellent questions. In terms of risk, you know, the ones you mentioned, especially stopping smoking, is critical, and I think I would take it one step beyond that. In addition to stopping smoking yourself, try to convince your immediate family members to stop smoking as well, because coming home to a house full of cigarette smoke, is, you know, even if you yourself are not the smoker, isn't the best thing either. In terms of other measures, whether dietary or behavioral, the answer to that one is it remains unknown. We haven't yet found a lifestyle change besides cigarette cessation that has been associated with a lower risk of lung cancer. In terms of e-cigarettes, you know, I think that we don't have enough data. And so I'm not ready to declare them safe by any stretch. You know, I think that when we look historically at lung cancer, the general time from when folks start smoking or otherwise exposed to the potential risk factor to the time they develop lung cancer is about 30 years. We see that in population data too. You know, from when Americans really started smoking actively after World War I, and when we first started seeing a big increase in the incidence of lung cancer, about 30 years later. And so, frankly, I don't think the product has been around long enough for us to be able to say with any certainty whether it's going to affect lung cancer rates. But I would remain concerned. I'm not ready to exonerate it.
Can you speak a little bit more about the connection between radon and lung cancer? And then to follow up, what are the chances that someone who doesn't smoke will get lung cancer?
Yep. So we talked a little bit about some of these things already. That is to say, we recognize that smokers have about a 20-fold increase in incidence of lung cancer compared to a non-smoker. That having been said, non-smokers still do have some baseline risk and represent about 15% of lung cancers in this country. With regards to radon is an inhaled form of radiation. And so like all forms of radiation, there's a risk there for cancer with radiation in general. And because radon is inhaled, you know, that the risk is specifically or particularly for lung cancer. And so radon checking and then subsequent radon abatement we think is important. And it usually involves better ventilation. And so that is important. In terms of numbers, it's hard to say. Some studies or population analyses have radon potentially as the second highest risk factor for lung cancer after smoking. That having been said, it's a distant second.
A couple other questions from our Facebook viewers. Should a person being treated for COPD be given a CT scan to check for lung cancer?
So it's not COPD alone, but the common theme there, as with so many things we've talked about this morning, is cigarette smoking. That is, most people with COPD have it because of their cigarette use. And so, as alluded to, in terms of lung cancer CT screening, the current guidelines are for anyone with at least 30 pack years of cigarette smoking, and if they've quit, that they've quit within the last 15 years. And so, and then more specifically, from the ages of 55 to 80 are the current guidelines for lung cancer screening recommendations based on the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force guidelines.
Do you assign a pack year to someone who lived with a smoker?
We have not found a good way to quantify secondhand smoke exposure in the same way, because it would depend not only, you know, on so many other variables, how much time you spend in the environment, how heavy the person smoked. So we don't have as clean a way to define a quantitative account for secondhand smoking the way we do for firsthand smoking.
Another Facebook question: how successful are PET scans in finding cancer?
Yep. So we don't primarily use PET scans as a diagnostic tool, but rather as a staging tool. So what is a PET scan? A PET scan is a scan that is usually paired with a CAT scan, and a special dye is injected. It's a special form of sugar, so that cells that are hungrier eat more of the sugar, and it makes them light up on the scan. This isn't unique to cancer. That is, other cells may light up too. You know, just cells that are at baseline more active, things like heart or brain. Cells that may be inflamed or areas of infection may also light up. So it's not specific for cancer, but rather we use PET scans in patients who have already been diagnosed with cancer. We use them to help to figure out, are there any other areas that might be involved? PET scans can't find us tiny things. It's not that a PET scan has a finer resolution than a regular CAT scan and is going to find us an area of cancer that's only 1 millimeter big. No, to light up on a PET scan, things usually have to be almost a centimeter large or greater to light up. So it's not finding us small things, but it is finding us things that it is nonetheless helping us to find some areas that might not have been as easily appreciated on a regular CT scan.
Great. And can you speak a little bit more about immunotherapy? How long should a patient stay on immunotherapy, and what side effects should someone on immunotherapy look for?
Sure. So in terms of how long should someone stay on immunotherapy in general, we think about using the treatment as long as it's working and not causing bad side effects. In terms of the optimal duration, if it continues to work, do you just stay on it for years, or do you stop after 1 or 2 years? The answers to that are still being explored. When we first started using these drugs in melanoma, the plan was you just use them for as long as they work. You know, when they were studied in lung cancer, many of the clinical trials were written such that if they continued to work, after 2 years, you got a break, because we recognized that some of these patients at that point, their immune system had been trained, if you will, and that the cancers, seemed to remain under control without needing to get more of the medicine. So the optimal long-term duration is unclear, but at least in the short term, as long as it's working and not causing bad side effects, one continues on it. It's not you get two cycles and you stop. In terms of side effects, the side effects for immune therapies are qualitatively different than the side effects from, say, chemotherapy, because of how they work. Because they're trying to train your immune system to search and destroy in a more effective way, some of the risks are that your immune system may attack some part of you. And so the risk is for inflammation of, well, just about anything. That doesn't mean every patient gets each of these side effects. It doesn't even mean that each patient gets any of them, but they're all possible, and that could be inflammation of scalp, eyes, brain, thyroid, lungs, heart, liver, kidneys, muscles, joints, just about anything. The things we see the most commonly are things like fatigue, diarrhea from inflammation of the colon, rash, inflammation of thyroid, which can disturb thyroid function. The things that we worry about the most are inflammation of things like brain, heart, and lungs. For me, particularly lungs, because while this is incredibly rare, when it happens, sometimes it can be severe. And so we certainly have to be on the lookout for these things.
Great. That's all the time we have. Thank you so much, Dr. Jackman. If you've missed part of this web chat or you'd like to go back and view it again, you can find it here on Facebook after this broadcast has ended, or you can go to danafarber.org/webchats. Thank you again.
Thank you.